थैंक यू सो मच प्रभु फॉर वंस अगेन काइंडली वेलकमिंग मी सो वार्मली इन टू दिस वंडरफुल संगा ऑफ डिवोटीज कनेक्टेड टू इस्कॉन ऑफ पोर्टलैंड एंड आई एम वेरी वेरी फॉर्चुनेट दैट आई हैव बीन काइंडली इन्वाइटेड टू स्पीक समथिंग ऑन द पास्ट टाइम्स ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्णा एंड एज आई सेड यस्टरडे दैट दिस पास्ट टाइम्स ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्णा दे not only purify those who are listening but they also most importantly purify those who are speaking them so the main purpose of my speaking them here is so that I can study them nicely once again and I can be even more purified you correctly said Prabhu that different acharyas have different realizations because the nature of one's realization corresponds to one's faith and this is the beauty of studying the Srimad Bhagavatam from the viewpoints of the various acharyas even in the scientific world in the modern world we see that the universe exists as one reality in front of us but scientists have made various models of the universe to explain the universe There is something known as string theory. Now, string theory is one way of explaining the universe, but it is the opinion of certain scientists. And certain other scientists explain the same universe using mathematics. And certain other scientists explain the same universe using different viewpoints. And all of them respect each other's viewpoint without contradicting each other. And all of them accept the viewpoints of each other as valid. So this is because the universe is unlimited, just as Krishna is unlimited. So different philosophers see the universe from different points of view. Similarly, Srimad Bhagavatam itself is non-different from Krishna because it is the word incarnation of Krishna, Aksharmay Krishna. If Krishna were to ever take the form of words, that would be Srimad Bhagavatam. So Srimad Bhagavatam is nothing but Krishna appearing in the form of words. And since it is Krishna appearing in the form of words, we will definitely find so many unlimited aspects in Srimad Bhagavatam that we find in Lord Krishna himself. So our Shisht Parampara, our tradition amongst the previous Acharyas, is to begin with Mangalacharan. Auspicious invocations. Sometimes some atheists they ask what is the use of performing Mangalacharan? Why should we perform auspicious invocations every time? Because even without performing auspicious invocations the program can still go on and the program can still attain success. So what is the use of performing Mangalacharan? So to this The associates of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, such as Sri Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, they reply by saying that even the atheist, when they begin their programs or events, they have a desire for mangal auspiciousness in their heart. Because no atheist desires that may my program fail or may my event fail. So the atheist also performs mangal or auspiciousness within their heart. So if the desire for auspiciousness is present within the heart of even an atheist, why not verbally speak out that desire in the form of prayers? So dear devotees, previous acharyas have established this tradition of reciting prayers for invoking auspiciousness. So I will sing those prayers. Most of us are aware of those prayers, so you can kindly sing along with me. ओम अज्ञान तिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले सोयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं वंदेहं श्री गुरु श्री युतपदकमलं श्री गुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्री रूपं सागर जातं सह गण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्री राधा कृष्ण पादां सह गण ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च नमः ओम विष्णु पादाय कृष्ण प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे नमो महावदान्याय कृष्णाब्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नामने गौरत्विषे नमः हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय जय गौर प्रेमानंदे हरि हरि बोल। So thank you Jayachinandan Prabhu for kindly inviting me once again, and thank you Narottam Vilas Prabhu for kindly hosting the entire event so nicely. Thank you all of you dear devotees for kindly being present here today, because today we are discussing the second part of the pastime of Krishna Leela. This is the killing of Putana. Dear devotees, this sculpture that you see in front of you is a 16th century wooden sculpture which is preserved in the Art Museum of Chicago. So those devotees who stay in Chicago, the art museums are going to open on 30th of July. So you can visit the Art Museum at Chicago and the 16th century wooden carving of Krishna Leela with Putana, Krishna sucking the life out of Putana's breasts, is on display in the Art Museum of Chicago. So dear devotees, we are continuing with the killing of Putana. This is the second part of our three-part presentation. Yesterday we had paused at that particular event where Krishna had closed his eyes in front of Putana, and we saw the realizations of the previous acharyas as to why Krishna closed his eyes. Usually we begin with a statement by Srila Prabhupada. This time too we are not going to make an exception. We will be beginning with a statement of Srila Prabhupada. So dear devotees, Srila Prabhupada gives a very important instruction to all of us. Srila Prabhupada Uvacha, the Prabhupada says, a sincere devotee must therefore be prepared to hear the Vedic literature like the Upanishads, Vedanta and other literature left by the previous authorities or Goswamis for the benefit of his progress. Without hearing such literature, one cannot make actual progress. And without hearing and following the instructions, the show of devotional service becomes worthless and therefore a sort of disturbance in the path of devotional service. Unless, therefore, devotional service is established on the principles of Shruti, Smriti, Purana and Pancharatra authorities, the make show of devotional service should at once be rejected. So Srila Prabhupada is giving a very seemingly heavy instruction to all of us, because Srila Prabhupada says here that a devotee who is sincere must therefore be prepared to hear Vedic literature such as Upanishads, Vedanta, etc. And not only that, other literatures left by previous authorities or Goswamis for the sake of his progress. Dear devotees, this is a very important statement by Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada has made this statement because one of the regrets that Srila Prabhupada sometimes expressed in his talks and lectures is that although I have written so many books and my disciples are distributing these books, but my disciples don't read my books so often. So this was one of the regrets that Srila Prabhupada expressed in quite a few of his lectures. And as his sons or grandsons, his grandchildren, we should try to do something to read Srila Prabhupada's books very seriously. And Srila Prabhupada doesn't want us to simply stop at reading the books that he has written. In his own words here, in the purport to Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said very clearly that without reading or hearing such literature, one cannot make actual progress. So very clearly given in Srila Prabhupada's own words. Sometimes devotees, they say that Srila Prabhupada also told certain devotees that they should not read the literature of the previous acharyas. So this doubt is also sometimes brought up. But those specific statements are there in the letters or conversations or morning walks, whereas the statements to read the previous acharyas are given right there in the books. So when we say that what are the law books in ISKCON, so we don't say that the conversations are the law books or the morning walks are the law books. We very clearly say that Srila Prabhupada's books are the law books. And in the law books, Srila Prabhupada has given those statements which he intends to give the general audience of devotees. So to the general audience of devotees, Prabhupada is giving this instruction many times, that those who are sincere, those who are serious, should definitely read the literature which has been left by the previous acharyas. Yesterday, I also showed another statement from the purport to the first verse of the Bhagavatam, where Prabhupada is giving a list of all the commentators. And all these commentators, Srila Prabhupada says, and the serious students would do well to attempt to go through these commentaries in order to better relish the message of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So it's very clear in Srila Prabhupada's own words. And we should try to follow these words by Srila Prabhupada, because ultimately we want to become serious. Ultimately we want to go deep in the ocean of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is such a literature that we will not be able to find only one meaning in Srimad Bhagavatam. There are multiple meanings in Srimad Bhagavatam, and these multiple meanings are given in Srimad Bhagavatam in Chaitanya Charitamrita. I would like to point out this verse from Chaitanya Charitamrita, where it is said in Chaitanya Charitamrita that Krishna Tulya Bhagavata Vibhu Sarvashray Prati Shloke Prati Akshare Nana Arthakai. This is Madhya Lila, 24th chapter, verse number 318. So it said Krishna Tulya Bhagavata. Actually, Srimad Bhagavatam is Krishna Tulya, identical with Krishna. Vibhu, it is the Supreme Lord Sarva Ashray, and it is the origin of everything, or that which controls everything, or that which gives shelter to everyone in the world. Prati Shloke Prati Akshare. In every verse, prati shloke, prati akshara, in every term, in every syllable, nana arthakaya, Srimad Bhagavatam reveals various meanings. So I said yesterday, it's like a Vaidurya Mani. If you look at it from different angles, you will find different meanings in Srimad Bhagavatam. Let's see the translation by Srila Prabhupada. Srimad Bhagavatam is as great as Krishna, the Supreme Lord and the shelter of everything. In each and every verse of Srimad Bhagavatam and in each and every syllable, there are various meanings. So dear devotees, There it is right there in Chaitanya Charitamrita that you won't find one meaning in Srimad Bhagavatam. We will find multiple meanings in Srimad Bhagavatam. And coincidentally, the name of the chapter is the 61 explanations of the Atmaram verse. So it is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself who is the personification of multiple understandings of Srimad Bhagavatam, because he himself is giving 61 explanations of the Atmaram verse. And somebody may ask, you know, which explanations are bona fide and which are not bona fide. So all explanations are bona fide primarily because they are coming from the mouth of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will say all of them are bona fide because I am quoting Vedic literature to support all of them. Because I am quoting literature which are very closely associated with the Vedas. I am deriving all the meanings from the standard dictionaries such as Vishwa Prakash, Vishwa Kosh, Amar Kosh. And all these meanings were derived from these dictionaries by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And therefore all the meanings that he derived have become completely bona fide. So dear devotees, for the serious students, it is a must to explore Srimad Bhagavatam from these various angles. After we have seen the basic meaning that has been given to us in the English language by Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada has given us one meaning, one aspect of Srimad Bhagavatam. And in some verses, he has also given multiple aspects. But if we want to explore even more than that, then we have to turn to the pages of the commentaries of the previous acharyas. Unfortunately, sometimes there is a culture that some devotees may themselves not read the literature by previous acharyas, and they may disallow other devotees from reading too. So sometimes this is found in the society of devotees, and our previous acharyas were very well aware that some devotees do like this. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Krishna Samhita chapter 8 verse number 20, I am showing this in front of all of you. In Krishna Samhita chapter 8 verse number 20, Bhaktivinoda Thakur speaks about Dhenukasur, and he says that Dhenukasur is also present. Dhenukasur is the donkey demon or the ass demon. And he says Dhenukasur is also present in the heart of certain devotees. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says the ass cannot eat the sweet palm tree fruits, and he opposes others' attempts to eat them. So this was Talwan. The fruits were so high that Dhenukasur himself was not eating them, and he was not allowing the cowherd boys to eat them. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says the purport is that the previous acharyas of the authorized sampradayas have written many spiritual literature which people with gross discrimination neither understand now nor allow others to see. So this is very clearly a statement by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, where he is critiquing those devotees. He is specifically critiquing devotees who neither study the previous acharyas themselves and who prevent others from studying the previous acharyas. And then he says, ass-like devotees, so using a very strong term here, who are simply interested in regulative principles and are under the control of gross discrimination, are unable to attain a higher platform. So it's very clearly given here that those who are simply interested in following regulative principles and maintain the routine without having an interest in exploring Lord Krishna's charitra, from various Lord Krishna's pastimes, Lord Krishna's name, Lord Krishna's character, so from various angles. So such individuals are not able to advance in the science of bhakti. So their condition is like Dhenukasur, who himself doesn't eat the high-hanging tal fruit and he doesn't allow others to eat. So dear devotees, this is something, some words from Srila Prabhupada as well as from previous acharyas about understanding literature from multiple angles of view. So I don't wish to take a detour here into this topic. I want to continue Putana's past time, because we were exploring last time that Krishna is on the lap of Putana and Krishna has closed his eyes. So this is where we left off last time, and this is where from where we are going to continue. So this was the verse which we discussed last time. Vibhudhyatam balakamarika graham chara charatma sanimilite kshana anantamarupayadankavantakam yathorakam suptama buddhirajyudhihi. So this is 10th canto, 6th chapter, verse number 8. So Vibhudhya, understanding her to be balaka marika graham, to be an infant killer. Chara charatma, so he is the lord of all moving and non-moving entities. Ta nimilite kshana, he closed his eyes. He closed his eyes. Anantamaropa yadankam antakam. And she placed the infinite lord, the cause of her death, on her lap, just as a fool places a sleeping serpent on the lap, mistaking it to be rope. So this is the verse where we paused yesterday. And today we are moving ahead, dear devotees, because we are going to discuss the five reasons for closing the eyes. These five reasons are given by our Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharya Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. So we are going to discuss these five reasons which have been given by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. And we will see these reasons in the words of Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur himself. So we will see the original words that have been written by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. That is what adds authenticity to a specific reading of Bhagavatam, is that if we directly quote the Acharyas. Anyways, our culture is as it is. As it is means as it has been specified, not only by Lord Krishna, but as it is specified by the previous Acharyas too. So dear devotees, the first reason that Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur specifies in his commentary is Nijatyant Balatva Dhirutva Gyapanaya. So what was the reason that Krishna closed his eyes? The first reason that Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says is to show that he is a small child, extremely small child, Nija Atyanta Balatva. So to show his extreme childish nature, and Bhirutva, that he is afraid of such fierce demons, Gyapanaya, to show these things. So this is the first reason why Krishna did so, why Krishna closed his eyes. This is the first reason. The second reason is Tadrisha Amangala Darshana Abhavaya. Tadrisha Amangala Darshana Abhavaya. Tadrisha Amangala. So Putana is Amangal, inauspicious. And Tadrisha Amangala, such inauspicious persons like Putana, Darshana Abhavaya, should never be seen. I don't want to see such inauspicious entities such as Putana. So to avoid seeing such an inauspicious demon like Putana, Krishna closed his eyes. This is the second reason given by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Third reason Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur gives is Swadrishti Swabhavika Tadvidha Dharshana Abhavaya. So Krishna was thinking that if I open my eyes and I am the Supreme Lord in front of whom no cheating tendency can remain. See, cheating tendency is one of the four defects. We know the, what are the four defects. Bhram, Pramad, Vipralipsa, Karana, Patav. Vipralipsa is cheating tendency, one of the four defects. And these four defects cannot remain in front of Lord Krishna. So, if Krishna would have opened his eyes, Putana would no longer be able to maintain her cheating tendency and her true form would be exposed. So no cheating can remain in front of the vision of the Lord. So the Lord wanted this cheating to continue for some time. Therefore, the Lord did not open his eyes immediately in front of Putana. So this is the third reason that Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur specifies for the Lord closing his eyes. Fourth is Matrabhava Darshikaya Stasya Swakartrakavade Lajjanupatyaiva. This is Matrabhava Darshika. She is somebody who has shown the mood of a mother. And Tasya Swakartrakavade, and Lord Himself is going to kill that lady who is showing the mood of a mother. So Lajjanupatyaiva. So he didn't want that embarrassment to arise by killing someone who has come in the mood of a mother. So in order to prevent that lajja, to that embarrassment which would arise if you know, he would see himself killing someone who has approached him in the mood of a mother. So the Lord closed his eyes. This is the fourth reason. And the fifth reason is Tan Marana Vaikalya Darshana Bhavaya. And he did not want to see her Marana Vaikalya, the suffering of her death, in front of his own eyes. So, dear devotees, these are the five reasons that Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur points out to us. You can see in the painting in the background, the hidden face of Putana is visible to all of us, although Lord Krishna is there sitting on her lap. Now, at this point of time, Sri Hari Suri, he makes a very important point. He says, you know, please check the original verse, because there is something there in the original verse. And what is there in the original verse? So I'll go back a few slides and we will see the original verse. And this is the verse, dear devotees. And Sri Hari Suri says, let's focus on the term Characharatma in the second line. You can see Characharatma in the second line in the verse. And Characharatma means he is the Atma, the Lord of Chara, moving and Achara, non-moving entities. So this is the meaning of Characharatma. So he says, therefore, this is also one of the reasons why the Lord has closed his eyes. He has closed his eyes because he is about to drink poison. And the Lord knows that within his stomach, all the universes are residing. So if the Lord drinks poison, that poison will reach his stomach, which is the shelter of all the unlimited universes. And since he is Characharatma, the Lord of all moving and non-moving entities who are situated within his stomach, all those living entities were very afraid when they saw that the Lord is now about to consume poison. They thought that the time for annihilation of the universe is now approaching because the Lord is about to drink poison. So the Lord wanted to console them, but he will only be able to console them if his vision is turned inwards, because all the universes are inside him. So Sri Hari Suri says that for this reason, in order to console all the living entities, the Lord turned his vision inwards by closing his eyes. Dear devotees, this is how an expert commentator takes a word from the original verse itself and explains the reason for the Lord closing his eyes. So, as I said, this particular commentator is a very remarkable commentator, because this name which he has been given, Suri, this name was given to him by the Lord himself. The Lord addressed him by two names, Arbhaka and Suri. And Suri or Shauri means a very learned scholar. And Srila Prabhupada, in one of the initiation ceremonies in which he was initiating our Hari Shauri Prabhu, so he gave the meaning of Hari Shauri, and he gave the same meaning that has been that is the name of our commentator Sri Hari Suri. So Srila Prabhupada says, when he is initiating Hari Shauri Prabhu, Srila Prabhupada says the following, and this is the exact time when Srila Prabhupada is initiating. He says, so your name is Hari Shauri. So Shauri means learned scholar, and Hari is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So one who is a learned scholar in the science of Krishna. So this is the meaning of the term Hari Suri. So the Sanskrit term is Suri, S-U-R-I. And sometimes it is also pronounced as Shauri. So this is his name when Srila Prabhupada is initiating his disciple, whom he gave the name of Sri Hari Suri. So how did Srila Prabhupada come to know about Sri Hari Suri? This is also very important. Because Srila Prabhupada, when he was in Vrindavan, he also spent some time with a particular sannyasi whose name is Sri Akhandanand Saraswati. And Sri Akhandanand Saraswati had published Hari Suri's commentary. So he was frequently speaking to Sri Akhandanand Saraswati when Prabhupada was visiting Vrindavan. So that was the reason why Srila Prabhupada knew about this personality who has written a commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam. So moving ahead, dear devotees, coming back. So this is the realization that he has given about Putana's about the Lord closing his eyes in front of Putana. Now there is another commentator, and he is from a Vaishnav Sampradaya. This is the Nimbarka Sampradaya. This is one of the four authorized Vaishnav Sampradayas who are coming in the disciplic succession from the Lord himself. So his name is Sri Shuka Sudhi. This is the only commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam from the Nimbarka Sampradaya. He says a very beautiful point. He says, Kapata Yukte Napi Aradhitas Tadvasho Bhavati Iti Suchitam. So it is indicated by the Lord here that even if one worships him with deceit, the Lord can still become controlled by such a person. Now, how is it? Because the Lord allowed himself to be seated on her lap. Usually, if the Lord doesn't want, he will not sit even on Mother Yashoda's lap. This is what Shuka Sudhi is saying. And that is going to happen in the pastime of Trinavarta. Because in the pastime of Trinavarta, the Lord becomes so heavy that even Mother Yashoda is unable to pick him up or keep him on her lap. So when the Lord wants, he becomes so heavy that nobody is able to pick him up. What to speak of feeding him milk. So, but in this case, the term Ananta was used in the verse. He's Ananta, but still he allowed himself to be picked up in the lap of Putana. The reason he says, Sri Shuka Sudhi says, is Kapata Yuktenapi. Somebody may be very deceitful, but Aradhita, somebody is worshipping the Supreme Lord in the mood of a mother. Still, Tadvashyo Bhavati. The Lord becomes controlled by such a deceitful person also for some time. And Iti Suchitam. This is indicated by the Lord here. The dear devotees, very sweet realization by commentators coming from various sampradayas. And they are all churning this nectar, and they have one purpose in their mind. The purpose which they have in their mind is, let the pastimes of Lord Krishna, let them be heard from various angles. Let everyone develop this attraction towards the Lord. Dear devotees, if in our reading of Srimad Bhagavatam, if any particular acharya is able to establish our mind, or is able to fix our mind into Lord Krishna, then we should definitely follow and we should see what that acharya says. Actually, Narad Muni says in the 7th canto something about this, and I want to point this out. Narad Muni says in this verse, you can see the verse in front of you, this is 7.132. He says, Tasmat kenapi upayena manaha krishne niveshayat. And Srila Prabhupada says that therefore one must somehow think of Krishna. Somehow or other one should think of Krishna in any way whatsoever. Whatsoever helps us in thinking of Krishna, that we should do. And Rupa Goswami takes this statement in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu and says, Yena kena prakarena manah Krishna niveshayat. Somehow or other, whatever it takes, invest your mind in Krishna. So if it takes multiple commentaries, let that be so. But somehow or other, invest your mind in Krishna. So dear devotees, this is very important for us to understand. Coming back to our pastime. So at this point of time, Krishna began sucking out her life airs from her body, because Krishna is now drinking the so-called breast milk of Putana, and this is nothing but poison smeared on her breasts. So you can see another painting of Lord Krishna trying to drink breast milk from Putana. This is a painting in the mural style of Kerala from South India. So this is a very nice painting where Lord Krishna is sucking out the life airs of Putana, and Srila Shukadev Goswami describes this in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Tasmin stanam dur jaravirya mulbanam gaurankamadaya shishurtadavatha gadham karabhyam bhagavan prapidyatat pranai samam rosha samanvito bibat. So tasmin stanam, so in that very place where she was seated, stanam dur jaravirya, so she pushed her breast into his mouth. Durjara Viryam Ulbanam, and this breast was smeared with a dangerous, immediately effective poison. That poison was supposed to kill immediately, not after some time. It was immediate death for those children who were drinking her breast milk. And Ghoranka Madaya Shishor Dadavatha. So she immediately pushed it into his mouth. And what did Krishna do immediately? But the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, becoming very angry, Rosha Samanvito, at her, took hold of her breast, Gadam Karabhyam, squeezed it very hard with both hands, Karabhyam, Prapidya, and sucked out both the poison and her life. So Pranai Samam, Rosha Samanvito, Apibat. Apibat means he drank. Apibat. Piba means to drink. But Apibat means he drank away not only what was there on her breast, but along with that, he sucked away her life air. So this, dear devotees, Lord Krishna literally drank her life airs. This is mentioned in this verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. So he sucked out both the poison and her life. Dear devotees, this is what is explained by Srila Shukadeva Goswami. And at this point of time, the devotee poet Sri Hari Suri says that he is going to liberate Putana, even though she has done such a terrible deed of feeding poison to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Actually speaking, those who give poison, those who administer poison, are fit to be killed, because it is given in Shastra, and Prabhupada points this out in his purport to Bhagavad Gita, that there are six aggressors, and he is pointing this out in Bhagavad Gita. This he has seen in the commentary of Srila Sridhar Swami. Sridhar Swami originally in his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita has pointed out six aggressors. Agnido garadas chaiva shastra panir dhanapah kshetradara pahari cha shadete yata taginah. Agnido, one who sets fire to someone's home, that is the first aggressor. Garadah, one who administers poison. Shastra panihi, one who attacks with weapons. Dhanapah, one who steals wealth. Kshetra dara paharicha, and one who snatches property as well as one's spouse. These six are known as aggressors. And it is said that one can kill these six aggressors. And Putana is one such aggressor. So she is fit to be killed. According to Dharma Shastra, she is fit to be killed. And therefore, the Lord is going to kill her. And the Lord need not deliver her from birth and death. But still the Lord is going to deliver her from birth and death. What is the reason? Sri Hari Suri says, Durvartma gostu yadiva vishama swabhavo. Durvartma gostu. Durvartma go means somebody may be walking on the twisted paths of life, on the deviated paths of life, like Putana was walking. She didn't come to Gokula on the royal highway. She came flying through the twisted paths. She didn't take the straight roads to Gokula. So she is flying here and there on the twisted paths of life. And Vishama Swabhavo. Vishama Swabhavo, this word has two meanings. Somebody's behavior may be very toxic. And in the case of Putana, not only is her behavior toxic, she herself is toxic because she has spread poison on her breasts. So somebody may be toxic in their behavior. But Mam Ched Dhiya Hridi Dadhati Yaya Kayapi. But if somebody offers their heart to me, so he's giving a dual meaning to this, because if a particular person offers their heart to me, and second meaning is if somebody offers their breast to me, in the case of Putana, this is the meaning. So, tam mochayami bhava bandhana tastadaiva. Lord Krishna says, at that point of time, I will deliver them from the repeated cycle of birth and death. Etat sputi kritami heshwara putanaya. This is the clear message that the Lord is giving through this pastime of Putana. So a person may be traversing on all the incorrect paths in life, like Putana, or may be completely toxic in their behavior, like Putana. But if that person holds me close to the heart even once, then I will definitely liberate them. This is the clear message from the pastime of Putana. A very important message which is being given by the Lord in this pastime. Dear devotees, at this point of time, what happened is described in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Unbearably pressed in every vital point, at every vital point, she began to feel immense distress. The demon Putana began to cry, "Please leave me. Leave me. Muncha, muncha. Suck my breast no longer." Perspiring, so she started perspiring, her eyes wide open and her arms and legs flailing. So she threw her arms and legs in the air. She cried very loudly again and again. So as Putana screamed loudly and forcefully, the earth with its mountains and outer space with its planets trembled. The lower planets in all directions vibrated and people fell down, fearing that thunderbolts were falling upon them. So dear devotees, all this happened when Putana was shouting out. So Putana just took him and ran out of the home of Nanda Maharaj and Mother Yashoda. And as she was running, we can visualize in our mind, her form is suddenly changing from that beautiful lady, and her form is suddenly changing into the ghastly demon that she was. So we can visualize her running out of the home of Nanda Maharaj with baby Krishna still holding on to her breasts. And as she is running out, the gopis are horrified seeing that our child has been taken away by her, and she is shouting out loudly. So they don't even know what is happening at this point of time, and she's shouting out loudly, and they feel that she's about to kill or slaughter our dear Krishna. And as she is running away, her true form is becoming visible. She is becoming bigger in size, and all her true bodily features are coming out. So dear devotees, all of us can imagine or visualize this in our hearts. All of us, we can see this in our hearts, what Sri Shukadeva Goswami is narrating here. So this is what was happening. Sometimes devotees feel that she flew out, but any mention of her flying out is not there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. She simply took Krishna and ran out of the home of Nanda Maharaj. And she ran out till the point that she could sustain her life breath. But as soon as Krishna sucked all the life breaths out of Putana, she immediately fell down on the ground with that immense, huge form of hers. So moving ahead, Putana falls on the ground. It's said here in the Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th chapter, 13th verse. Nishacharittam yathitastana vyasur vyadaya kesham charano bhujavapi prasarya goshthe nijarupamasthita vajrahato vritra ivapatanripa. So Nishachari, she was actually Nishachari. She was a demoness who was traveling at night everywhere she used to go at night. So she is Nishachari. Ittham, in this way, vyathitastana, she became very aggrieved in her breasts, very pained in her breasts. Vyasu, vyadaya kesham charanau bhujavapi. So she spread wide her arms and her legs, and her hair also was disheveled. She fell down in the pasturing ground. So prasarya goshthe nijarupam asthita vajrahato vritra ivapatan. So she fell down exactly as Vritrasur had fallen when killed by the thunderbolt of Indra. So an analogy is given. Just as Vritrasur had fallen on being struck by Indra, similarly she fell down. At this point of time, Srila Jiva Goswami says she fell down on the borders of Gokula. And on the borders of Gokula, there was, on the other side of the border, there was the Udyan, or a particular small forest belonging to Kamsa. And all the trees that were killed were also belonging to the forest of Kamsa. So basically, even that she could not even harm a single tree in Gokula. This is what Srila Jiva Goswami very clearly mentions in the commentary. The Acharyas are very particular in ensuring that none of the living entities in Vrindavan are ever harmed. And why would they be harmed anyways? Because Shukadeva Goswami himself is going to say that all the Vrajavasis enjoyed immense pastimes and none of them experienced any material suffering. We saw this yesterday. Jiva Goswami had proved this using the various verses in the Bhagavatam itself. So dear devotees, once again, I want to highlight these points. Very important to read these commentaries, because without understanding these commentaries such as Sandarbhas, six Sandarbhas of Jiva Goswami, it is impossible for us to understand the secrets of Krishna Lila. Impossible. And I say this not on the basis of you know, my own conviction or my own strength. There are many statements by Srila Prabhupada that one should definitely study the six sandarbhas. And there is a statement that Srila Prabhupada made. Yes, I want to show this statement to all of you so that this remains fixed in our mind. So Srila Prabhupada is saying in a lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam that Jiva Goswami has got these six sandarbhas, thesis, Bhagavat sandarbha, Krishna sandarbha, Tattva sandarbha, Preeti sandarbha, like that. So these books are, I don't think it is published in English. So these sandarbhas are so philosophically discussed that throughout the whole world, there is not a single philosopher who can defy these Jiva Goswami's six sandarbhas, our Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. So Prabhupada very, you know, happily is speaking about the six sandarbhas. And he sees not a single philosopher in the entire world can defy the six sandarbhas of Jiva Goswami. So, so this is what is given in by Srila Prabhupada. Many other glorifications are there. So Prabhupada is also saying that, you know, the late Pandit Pramathanath Tarkabhushan, one of the greatest scholars, Sanskrit scholars and authority of the modern age, remarked in one of his lectures that Jiva Goswami is the greatest philosopher of all ages in the world. So this is from a Back to Godhead magazine in 1956, before Prabhupada had any disciples in the West. So all these articles are personally supervised by Srila Prabhupada and written by Srila Prabhupada himself. So this is another statement by Srila Prabhupada that Jiva Goswami is the greatest philosopher. And because, why is it so? He specifies because of the six sandarbhas. So dear devotees, all of us, if we want to understand what is Krishna Tattva, so we want to, we should ideally pay close attention to the six sandarbhas of Srila Jiva Goswami. There is a very famous verse that is there in about the six sandarbhas. Sandarbha yena nadhitas tasya bhagavate shramaha. Sandarbha yena chadhita nasti bhagavate brahmaha. Sandarbha yena nadhitaha. One who has not studied six sandarbhas, tasya bhagavate shramaha, they will find it difficult when they are reading Srimad Bhagavatam to reconcile certain positions. But sandarbha yena chadhita, one who, those who have studied the six sandarbhas, nasti bhagavate brahmaha, for them there will be no difficulties in studying the Srimad Bhagavatam. So as we began, I spoke about the anxiety of Nanda Maharaj, and immediately there is a difficulty in our hearts. But that difficulty is resolved by Jiva Goswami in his sandarbhas. So it's very important to study this literature. So as Putana fell down, all the cows and cowherds came to the rescue, and it's described there in Srimad Bhagavatam that without fear, child Krishna was playing on the upper portion of Putana Rakshasi's breast. And when the gopis saw the child's wonderful activities, they immediately came forward with great jubilation and picked him up. Thereafter, Mother Yashoda and Rohini, along with the other elder gopis, waved about the switch of a cow to give full protection to the child, Shri Krishna. So this is what is happening, dear devotees, at this point of time. So you can see in the painting here that they are, this is Mother Yashoda. She is holding Krishna in her lap, and the various gopis, they are waving the switch of a cow. You can see the gopis waving the switch of a cow above Lord Krishna to give protection to him. So this is what is happening at this point of time, dear devotees. And moving ahead, what happened at that point of time was very important. The gopis performed something known as achaman. This achaman, all of us know what is achaman. Achaman means ritual sipping of water for purification is known as achaman. So Srila Shukadev Goswami describes, Gopyah samsprishta salila angeshu karayuh prithak nyasyatmanyathyava athavalasya bijanyasam akurvata. The gopis first executed the process of achaman, drinking a sip of water from the right hand. So when we perform achaman, dear devotees, achaman is usually performed two times. One is called as achaman, then there is punarachamanam. So achamanam is performed six times. Om Keshavaya Namaha, then is sip. Om Narayanaya Namaha, again sip. Om Madhavaya Namaha, again sip. Then one time we leave water on the ground. Govindaya Namaha, then Punarachamanam. Then again three times. Keshavaya Namaha, Narayanaya Namaha, Madhavaya Namaha. So total 6 times we perform Achaman. So this is called as Achamanam. So Prabhupada writes in the translation, gopis first executed the process of Achaman, drinking a sip of water from the right hand. They purified their bodies and hands with the Nyas mantra. There are various mantras which the gopis know, and then applied the same mantra upon the body of the child. So this is very important, and it's very important to note that even village ladies, they were expert in the art of chanting mantras. So ladies especially should be well aware of the science of chanting mantras. They should be well aware of mantras for protection. They should be well aware of which mantras to be spoken on which occasions. And it's not necessary that they should be Brahmin ladies. These are not Brahmin ladies. They are born in merchant families. They are Vaishyakul. But still they are born in Vaishyakul. They are knowing all the mantras which are needed for protection. So this is very important to note here. They know the process of Achman. They know all the mantras for protection. This is very clearly mentioned here. Now, there is one very important realization which I wanted to share at this point of time. The Paramaguru means the Guru of the Guru of Sri Hari Suri, has written one verse about this particular pastime. It's a very sweet verse. He says, the gopis may have performed their Achman, but Krishna performed his own Achman. Krishna has performed his own Achman before they have performed. And what is the Achman that he has performed? He wrote a very nice verse, very difficult to understand. But once we understand it, it's very sweet. He says, Parahasahasra Suravamsya Bhoji Stanyena Tasyaha Kila Krishna Kalaha Pranahutinam Sahapanchakena Manne Mritopas Taranam Chakara. So, he says this thing, that Krishna is indeed all destroying Kala, time. And Krishna is also Brahmanya Dev. He is the highest Brahmana. So just as when Brahmanas begin their feast, they perform Achaman 6 times before Brahmanas begin their feast. Because Brahmanas are known to be fond of Prasadam. Brahmana Bhojana Priya. Brahmanas are fond of having Prasadam. So when Brahmanas begin their feast, what they do is they first perform Achaman. So our Lord Krishna also performed Achaman. Achaman means sucking or sipping. He first performed Achaman 6 times. Why? Because he is like a Brahmana who is going to feast on all these demons. And he is going to perform Achaman. He is beginning with Putana. He performed Achaman by sipping the 5 life airs as well as the 6th is Putana's milk. So total is 6. So the 5 life airs we know, Pran, Apan, Udan, Vayan, Saman. These 5 were sucked by Krishna himself. Along with that, the breast milk of Putana, 6th. So in this way, our Lord Krishna has already performed Achaman and killed Putana. And the auspicious feast in which our Lord Krishna, who is Kala, he is going to slaughter all the demons. So our auspicious feast has begun with Putana. So somebody might say, how can you say that Lord Krishna consumes all these demons? So in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna is going to show Arjun how he will consume all the warriors on the battlefield. You must be knowing, when Krishna shows his universal form to Arjuna, at that time he sees, you know, all the Kauravas are being chewed by Krishna's teeth. Arjuna sees in that form, that terrible form, all the demons are being chewed by Krishna's teeth. So Sri Hari Suri's guru, his name is Sri Dhundi Raj. He says that our Lord Krishna began his demon feast with Putana, but before beginning the feast, you have to perform Achaman 6 times. So that Achaman was performed by sucking out her 5 life airs as well as her breast milk. So this is now, at this point of time, it should be known that the breast of a lady is known as Payodhara. Paya has 2 meanings. One meaning of paya is milk, and dhara means that which contains. So that which contains dhara, milk, that is paya, is known as payodhara. So a breast is called as payodhara. And from this payodhara, our Lord Krishna found that poison is arising from this payodhara. But another meaning of payodhara, because another meaning of payah is water. Payah also means water. So another meaning of payah dhar is that which contains water, that is the ocean. So Sri Hari Suri says at this point of time, Krishna was thinking, previously also poison was arising from payodhara. Previously poison arose from the ocean and somebody drank it. Dear devotees, we all know who drank that poison. That poison was drunk by Lord Shiva. But although he drank that poison, he did not deliver the person who was delivering the poison. Who was that? The ocean was the person who was delivering the poison. But this time also the poison is arising from payodhara. Means this time also it is arising from a breast. But this time I will ensure that I go one step ahead. And I also deliver the person who is delivering me poison. So dear devotees, he takes on the word payodhara and he says that how Lord Krishna was even more merciful than Lord Shiva, because in both conditions, when Lord Shiva was drinking poison, the entire universe was terrified that we will be destroyed. And when Lord Krishna was drinking poison, within his stomach, all the universes are there. So the entire universe was terrified that they will be destroyed. And in both cases, the poison is arising from payodhara. One payodhara means ocean, another payodhara means breast. And in both cases, Lord Shiva also consumed the poison, Lord Krishna also consumed the poison. But what is special in Lord Krishna is that he delivered that personality who administered poison to him. So this, dear devotees, is a special take on the word payodhara by the previous acharyas. I hope that you relished this special meaning of the term payodhara. Moving ahead, as I said in yesterday's class, on the sixth day, it is said that Lord Brahma comes along with a deity named Shashti Devi. And it is said in Shastras that they write this, birth chart or the destiny of the newborn is written on the sixth day. Dear devotees, on the sixth day, Lord Krishna, whose destiny was about to be fixed by Putana, he is the one who reversed that destiny, even though it was such an inauspicious nakshatra, inauspicious constellation, Ashlesha, even though it was Mrityu Yoga, it was the time when death takes place, even though it was Vishghatika, even though it was a very inauspicious time of the day. But instead of Lord Krishna's destiny being written by Putana, on the sixth day, it was Putana's destiny that was sealed by Lord Krishna himself. And how did he seal her destiny on the sixth day? He sealed her destiny by sucking out six things from her. That is the five life airs, as well as the sixth thing is the poison in the form of the milk. So the gopis finally chanted many auspicious mantras, and these mantras are given there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. What I would like to do is I would like to show some of these mantras that were being chanted by the gopis at this point of time. So I would like to show the mantras that the gopis were chanting. And these mantras have been given in Srimad Bhagavatam, and the gopis were chanting various names of the Lord. And these names are mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. I am specifying these names in front of all of you. And then we will read the translation given there. Please, dear devotees, have a look at this verse. This verse is in the meter Vasanta Tilakam, same meter as Brahma Samhita. This is Srimad Bhagavatam 10.6.22.23. Avyadajongri mani manstava janvathoru यज्ञोच्युतः कटितटं जठरं हयास्य ऋत्केशवस्त्वदुर ईश इनस्तु कंठं विष्णुर्भुजं मुखमुरुक्रम ईश्वरः कं चक्रग्रतः सह गदो हरिरस्तु पश्चात् त्वत्पार्श्वयोर्धनुरसी मधुहाजनश्च कोणेषु शंख उरुगाय उपर्युपेन्द्रः तार्क्षाक्षितौ हलधरः पुरुषः समन्ता. So, dear devotees, this is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And let's see the translation very quickly. Shukdev Goswami informed Maharaj Parikshit that the gopis following the proper system protected Krishna, their child, with this mantra. May Aja, that is the unborn Lord, protect your legs. May Maniman protect your knees. Yajna, your thighs. Achyuta, the upper part of your waist. Hayagriva, your abdomen. May Keshav protect your heart. May Ish protect your chest. May the sun god your neck. May Vishnu your arms. Urukrama your face and Ishwar your head. May Chakri protect you from the front. May Shri Hari, Gadadhari, the carrier of the club, protect you from the back. And may the carrier of the bow, who is known as the enemy of Madhu, and Lord Ajana, the carrier of the sword, protect your two sides. May Lord Urugaya, the carrier of the conch shell, protect you from all corners. May Upendra protect you from above. May Garuda protect you on the ground. And may Lord Haladhara, the Supreme Person, protect you on all sides. So in this way, they are chanting Vishnu mantras for the protection of the Lord. And moving ahead, Sri Shukadev Goswami says, Swapna drishta mahotpada vriddha bala grahaschaye sarve nashyantu te Vishnur nama grahana bhiravah. The demons may create very great disturbances, especially for children, like Putana created a great disturbance for children. But sarve nashyantu, but one can vanquish them simply by uttering Lord Vishnu's name. For when Lord Vishnu's name resounds, all of them become afraid and go away. Very clearly he says, and at this point of time, dear devotees, our sweet poet Sri Hari Suri says, dear Lord, let anybody say anything that you are very powerful. But today I have realized one fact, that more powerful than you is your holy name. Because when it comes to protecting you, the gopis used your holy name in protecting you. So dear Lord, this simple fact proves beyond a doubt that your holy name is more powerful than you. Because even when it came to your own protection, the gopis did not use any other technique, but they used your name. This, dear devotees, is the same conclusion that Srila Rupa Goswami and the Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharyas have given in their books. That Srila Rupa Goswami has said in Namashtakam, Vacham vachakamityudeti bhavato nama swarupadvayam purvasmat parameva hantakarunam tatrapi jani mahe. So, oh dear Lord, you have two forms, Vachya and Vachaka. One is your holy name and one is your threefold bending spiritual form. But I understand the holy name, Rupa Goswami says, to be more merciful than your threefold bending form. Because dear devotees, in Kali Yuga, how many of us have access to the threefold bending form of the Lord? How many of us can directly see that threefold bending form of the Lord in front of our eyes 24 hours a day? So we cannot see. I am saying this because some devotees will say, oh, we can go to the temple and see the deity. So I am saying 24 hours a day in front of our eyes. So we cannot see that deity form 24 hours a day in front of our eyes. But 24 hours a day, we can chant the names of the Lord and see through our ears. Shrutekshita patham. See through our ears. It is possible to see the Lord through our ears, as it is said in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Shrutekshita patham, simply by chanting Krishna's name. Dear devotees, this name is so powerful that when Krishna took birth, at that point of time also, Sri Hari Suri's Param Guru, whose verse I mentioned today, he made a very beautiful realization. So when Krishna appeared in this world, Krishna was present between both his parents. And one of the names of Krishna, which is given in Vishnu Sahasranam, is Deva. Deva means he who is very brilliant, glowing in his complexion, is known as Deva. Divyati iti Deva. One who glows, effulgent, is known as Deva. So Rupa Goswami has also used this name, Krishna Deva Bhavantam Vande. Krishna, O Deva. So Deva is a name for Krishna which is used, which has been used by Rupa Goswami also. So he uses this name and says, O Deva, when you appeared in that prison of Kamsa, everybody saw you between your parents, between your mother and father. Everybody saw you seated between your mother and father. But dear Lord, I saw you also on both sides of your parents. When I heard this verse, I could not understand what he's trying to say. When you appeared, dear Lord, everybody saw you between both your parents. But I also saw you on both sides of your parents. And I thought for 2 or 3 days, I could not understand what is the meaning. And then later I realized, actually, on Krishna's left side was his mother. On Krishna's right side was his father. And Krishna is being addressed with the name Deva. And on his left side is Devaki. So she also has Deva in her name. And on her right side is Vasudeva, who also has Deva in his name. So Deva was in the center. And on the left side was also Deva in the form of Devaki. And on the right side was also Deva in the form of Vasudeva. So in the form of his holy name, Deva was present on the left as well as right side of Krishna when Krishna appeared in this world. Because the holy name is not different from Krishna. So Deva himself in a threefold in his form was present between both his parents. And in the form of his holy name, he was present in his mother's name, Devaki, as well as in his father's name, Vasudeva. So in this way, he saw Krishna also on both sides of his parents. Not only did he see Krishna only in between both his parents. It's a very sweet realization, dear devotees. The holy name is non-different from Krishna. And for this reason, we say that holy name is non-different, but many times the Acharyas have expressed the opinion that the holy name is more merciful than Lord Krishna. And this is very clear in this pastime of Putana, where the gopis use Krishna's name to protect Krishna. At this point of time, I would like to pause for the second session. Tomorrow we'll go into various different aspects of Putana's pastime, because tomorrow I'll also be giving some thought to what Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur has said about Putana. Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur has taken a completely different angle about Putana's pastime, and I'm going to go into that detail also tomorrow. So tomorrow we'll see it from that point of view. But at this point of view, we would like to pause because everything is auspicious right now. All auspicious mantras are being chanted. So this is a good time for pausing. Dear devotees, I would like to pause at this point of time. And I would like to thank all of you once again for kindly giving me your time and your kind attention. Yadatra skalitam kinchit vidvam saha purayantu tat. Yadatra saushtavam kinchit tad guru reva me nahi. Yadatra skalitam kinchit. If there was any mistake, vidvam saha purayantu tat. You are all merciful devotees, learned devotees. You kindly correct those mistakes. But yadatra saushtavam kinchit. If you find anything nice in these realizations, dear devotees, please remember, tad guru reva. It belongs to my guru janas me nahi. It doesn't belong to me. Actually, these poets that I have been quoting, Sri Hari Suri, he is the favorite commentator of my Guru Maharaj, Sri Srimad Radha Govinda Das Goswami Maharaj on the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. You will not hear a lecture on 10th canto of Vrindavan pastimes from him without Hari Suri's name being mentioned. So it was he who initially kindled my interest in this personality. And when I told him that I am trying to translate because there are 4,650 verses and many of them are still untranslated. So when I told him that I am trying to translate them, he was very happy that an attempt is being made to translate. So these previous acharyas are enriching our experience of Krishna Bhakti. And I thank all of you for being a part of this journey in relishing this message of Krishna Bhakti, along with the previous acharyas and Srila Prabhupada. Thank you very much, dear devotees. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Hare Sari Parshad Prabhuji ki jai. Jai Gaur Pindu. Thank you very much, Prabhuji, for the Bhagavatam, the commentaries from the acharyas, and showing how they're consistent with each other in spite of different aspects of realizations and how we can be faithful to this process. So without further ado, the process that we've been following is devotees who want to speak out their questions can do so. Prabhuji, what's your time constraint? It's 6:50 a.m. in India right now.
Yes, bro. It's okay with me. It's okay with me. Devotees can ask. It's there is no problem. As long as devotees are okay. I mean, those devotees who have some seva, maybe they can, you know, they can take leave. And those who wish to stay for the question and answer, they can stay. That's what I think would be ideal. I'm here for answering the questions.
Very nice seva is to hear. So, devotees, if anyone has, I see one question in the, I see two questions in the chat window, but any, the preference is those that can speak their questions first, and then we'll take the chat ones subsequent.
Hare Krishna, may I ask one question?
Yes, please.
Hare Krishna, the source has been a very beautiful Nectarian class. Thank you so much. I had a question about Putana's deliverance as a mother when she was delivered by the Lord. Was it because specifically because she desired in her past life as a Bali Maharaj sister, to have Vamandeva as her son? Primarily because of that, or it was just
yes, though
not all the demons were delivered by the had such an exalted position. You know, many demons were killed by Krishna, but no one had such a exalted.
Yes, Prabhu. So this is also explained as one of the reasons why, you know, Krishna delivered her and gave her the position of a mother in the of a nurse in the spiritual world. So this is one of the reasons specified, because in her past life she had that desire towards the Lord, and that is a very valid reason, because it is mentioned in the Shastras by our previous acharyas too. So that is one of the reasons too, but the main reason here is that Krishna himself desired so. So because Krishna himself desired so, for this reason, that is the main reason for Putana achieving that destination. Because there are verses in the Bhagavatam that, Ahau Bhakti Yam Stana Kalakutam, that she is coming with a deadly poison on her breast. So Krishna is no longer obligated to give her the position of nurse or of Vatsalya Ras in the spiritual world. But still he has given that. So that is Krishna's, the purely Krishna's causeless mercy.
I was wondering, Prabhu, can we also get that, this kind of causeless mercy? Is it just or depends on the Lord?
Sure, why not, Prabhu? But we should not become unfavorable towards Krishna like Putana. At all points of time, we should expect the mercy of the Lord. Expecting the mercy of the Lord is one of the 64 limbs of bhakti in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Asha Bandha means always having that hope that Krishna will be merciful to me. Asha Bandha is one of the 64 limbs of bhakti. So how can I say that you should never expect Krishna? I will be speaking against Rupa Goswami if I say that. So expecting the mercy of the Lord is one of the 64 limbs of bhakti. So we should always expect the mercy of the Lord. But at the same time, we have to understand that anukulyena krishnanu shilanam. That we have to have anukulya, favorability towards Krishna, not unfavorable nature like Putana is demonstrating here. So this anukulya should be present within us in order to execute our bhajan in the line of Srila Rupa Goswami. There are many who have become unfavorable towards Krishna like Shishupal, but we don't want to become followers like that. We don't want to meditate on Krishna in that unfavorable way. Our meditation on Krishna should always be anukul or favorable meditation. So that is what is the answer to that question, Prabhu. So always, please always expect Krishna's mercy, and please never give up on Krishna, the hope of attaining Krishna's mercy. But not like Putana, because she was unfavorable. We will always remain favorable towards Krishna. That is the answer according to our Gaudiya Vaishnava Siddhanta.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Thank you again, class. My question is in regards to the aspect of time, Prabhuji. So, how can I understand that, and how can I understand that Putana is now serving Krishna as a mother, but she approached him like a mother too. Could one think that she was informed by her Swarupa to approach Krishna as a mother? You understand the okay. Perhaps my phraseology is incorrect, but is it because she actually was a mother in the spiritual world that she approached him, or is am I looking at time in the wrong way?
Oh, that this question goes in a very different philosophical direction. The root of this question is, were we originally present in the spiritual world before we came to the material world? That is the root of this question. Am I correct, Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Oh, that's... then this question takes a direction into, did we fall from the spiritual world or not? So, and that will... I don't know. You know, there are multiple answers given to this question by different acharyas. So that puts us in a zone which is not so black and white. So Srila Jiva Goswami has said in very clear words that Tato Askhalanam. In the Bhagavad Sandarbha, he says, I'm quoting his exact words, Tato Askhalanam. Nobody falls. But Srila Prabhupada has also said that we were there in the spiritual world. So that's a completely different direction, and you know, it requires immense reconciliation in order to understand. So I would suggest that at this point of time, maybe you can contact me personally and ask me so that I will be able to answer this question in some detail, because this question is going to take a turn in that direction where it comes to were we in the spiritual world. And if we were in the spiritual world, how did Maya enter into the spiritual world and make us envious of Krishna? So that is something which needs to be seen from the point of view of various acharyas, and it needs some reconciliation. But it needs some time. Most importantly, it needs some time. And therefore, I would request that you ask separately and privately. So that is my request, Prabhu. I hope that... this request is okay with you.
Absolutely. I very much look forward to association with you further. Thank you for this request.
Thank you, Prabhupada.
Hare Krishna.
Are there any other questions?
So, actually, I am also very interested in that answer, Prabhuji. My name is Param Karuna Das. Okay. Maybe I'll email you, or I'll request Diogo Prabhu to email you with putting me in the CC or something like that.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Prabhu. Prabhuji, this question is for everybody. I think everybody are eager to hear the answer for this.
Oh, Krishna.
Yes, Prabhuji.
They're all part and parcel of Krishna. Everybody, this is a primary question that we ask whenever we first join Bhakti.
Okay,
maybe I could, whatever answer I receive, I can forward it to the congregation. We have a mailing list.
Okay,
if
sure.
That works.
Sure. We can try to do something which helps all the devotees understand.
Hare Parshad Prabhu, I can reach out to you about this.
Yes,
I think your desire is to kind of refocus on this pastime.
Yes, Prabhu.
So, clearly, this is an age-old question, and so we'll come back to that later, like Prabhuji said. Any other?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhanavad Pranam. Thank you very much, Prabhu, for taking into depths of Srimad Bhagavatam, Chapter 6. So, Prabhuji, one question I have. You were pointing out how we have to read previous acharyas, and you were saying yesterday clearly we need to read Prabhupada books first and then go to previous acharyas.
Right.
Yeah. So, Prabhuji, my question is on the line of that one, not exactly Putana's pastimes, but if you go to verse number, Canto 1, Chapter 9, verse 33.
Okay. You want me to show it on the screen, Prabhu?
Yeah, please, Prabhuji. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Just 1 minute.
1933, Prabhu.
Yeah, here it is.
Yes, Prabhu. So this is, Bhishma Dev's prayers.
Right.
Yeah, I heard your lecture, Prabhu, on Bhishma Dev's Bhishma Stuti. that you gave, right? Two series lecture. So Prabhu, here the third line, Vapur Alaka. Alaka means hair, right? Curly hair, Prabhu.
Yeah.
But Prabhupada translated this line into like little bit different, where Lord Krishna is having sandal, decoration of sandalwood paste on his hair, on his face.
Okay.
So, you know, how do we understand that, Prabhu? Like, nowhere in the verse, it's like, you know, sandalwood paste is mentioned. Like if you see here, halaka kula avatra, covered with paintings of sandalwood pulp.
Right.
Yeah.
So, but like, what I will do is I will show you the standard commentaries of the acharyas on this specific verse, because I would like to see if Srila Prabhupada got that understanding from a certain commentary. Or I would like to see if there is something which was not mentioned in any of the previous commentaries. So what I will do is I will go to the various Sanskrit commentaries in this verse, and then we will try to see, Prabhu, if there is anything which is matching what Srila Prabhupada is saying. So I am showing you the commentaries, Prabhu. I'll show you Sridhar Swami's commentary first. So you can see here Sridhar Swami's Sanskrit commentary is here in front of all of us. So here says, he very clearly says, Alaka Kulair. Alaka Kulair means Upari Avritam Ananabjam Yasminstar. So very clearly Sridhar Swami says that his face was covered with locks of curly hair. This is the meaning of, this is standard meaning given by Sridhar Swami. So Jiva Goswami has given no commentary. And now let's see what Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur is saying. And Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Kitrishe Yatra Vapur Dadhane. No, he's not mentioning anything about Alaka here. So I can't see anything about Alaka. So it's not from the three primary commentators. So I think I'll have to check other commentators, because Prabhupada had the commentary of all the acharyas. I think he had 9 or 10 commentaries with him when he was translating. So I'll check those commentaries also, and if there is anything which is found in that, then you please leave me a Facebook message or your email address with Jai Sachinandan too, so that I can get back to you, Prabhu. But I can't see anything in the commentary of Sridhar Swami or Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur.
Yeah, thank you very much, Prabhu. So one more thing, Prabhu. Yeah. Like we see Prabhupada saying that whatever you need, I have given in my books.
Right.
So now how do we think about, you know, going into previous acharyas? Like Prabhupada is clearly saying, right, he's given everything that we need.
Yeah, therefore I gave a very cyclic logic. In his books itself, he has written that those who are serious should read the previous acharyas. So all that is needed is given in his books. That is very clear. And in his books, it is given that we should read the previous acharyas.
Okay.
So you can put A and B together and you get C.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Prabhu. Thank you very much.
Prabhuji, this lecture is going to be subsequently posted on our ISKCON Portland YouTube channel.
Okay.
And His Grace Hariparshad Prabhu addressed that question that you asked about reading other commentaries, in nice summary form. So I don't know whether you joined a little bit later, but if you can wait and then go onto the YouTube channel for ISKCON Portland, you'll find this summary of Prabhuji's explanation, which is quite nice. So maybe you can do that a little bit just after this class finishes. Yes. Just kind of rewind to the beginning.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, sure, Prabhu. Thank you very much.
Eric.
Are there other questions?
Prabhu, I also I would like to give opportunity for others to ask a question, but I also wanted to thank you very much for the manner in which you so with so much attention brought up all the different viewpoints. I think that by your which by the time that you spent and by the attention that you gave to the words, I felt like I was getting at least a gleam of how the spiritual world expands by seeing so many different perspectives and by Krishna being so clever with performing so many activities in apparently one. And so I appreciate that you gave me an experience of Krishna's eternal nature by analyzing these words so nicely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Diego Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Prabhu, can I ask one question, please?
Sure, Mataji.
Yes, thank you, Prabhu, for the class. Prabhu, I have just one concern. We say Arjuna is always there where Krishna is. So when there are pastime in another universe or another kalpa, are demons also kind of eternal or associates, or this is just the position and the demons change, like position, anyone can fill it up? How about that? If you can please shed some light on that. Thank you.
Sure. So demons are not eternal associates, because eternal associates are those who are favorable towards Krishna. So they who are anukul, they are eternal associates. So the demons are not considered as eternal associates. There was only one exception, and Srila Jiva Goswami points out this exception, that Jay and Vijay took the role of, you know, Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, and they took it only once, and they don't take it again and again in every universe. So this was only once for the sake of performing a certain pastime that the Lord wanted to satisfy. Only for that sake they took that particular role. Otherwise, demons are not constant associates of the Lord, because the constant associates of the Lord are those who have prema bhakti, and demons don't have that prema bhakti within their hearts. So for this reason, demons are not eternal associates of the Lord. They don't travel with the Lord. They are those conditioned souls in that universe who are destined to get delivered through the hands of the Lord, who are either cursed to be delivered, destined to be delivered in certain way, to be liberated by the Lord himself. So that is the reply to that question. I hope that reply satisfies.
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare
Krishna. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavat pranams. All glories to your service, Prabhu. Thank you so much for your wonderful association. Really loved the realizations that you brought about by Harisuri, and why Krishna is looking, why Krishna closed his eyes, and his commentary was fantastic, Prabhu. Really, thank you for such a wonderful class and bringing out this wonderful nectar, and then again pointing out that the holy name, from how his perspective of the holy name, and the word Deva is present in between in his father and mother, and how he's been present in between his parents. All that is something that we wouldn't have realized if not for you. And Prabhu, just about the commentator Harisuri, I mean, which sampradaya does he belong, and what is his guru's name, Prabhu? You talked about his guru's guru. I was just kind of curious, who's his guru?
I'll speak something about his sampradaya. It was very important to speak about which sampradaya he belongs to. So his commentary is a complete Vaishnava commentary on the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. In the beginning of his commentary, he wrote that I was ordered by the Supreme Lord, because I got one darshan of the Lord in my life. So I was ordered by the Supreme Lord to write this commentary on the various reasons behind the various pastimes. I went personally to Nasik in order to find out who is this commentator. So I went to his village in order to find out who is his commentator. And the ISKCON temple in Nasik organized a 3-session program where we were discussing Damodar Leela with Sri Hari Suri's commentary. Exclusive focus on his commentary and Damodar Leela. So really awesome points of view, because you might have heard about, sometimes you might have heard in many lectures in our ISKCON society, that why did the milk start boiling? The milk started boiling because it was thinking, if Krishna is drinking breast milk, then what is the use of my life? And one time, there was a senior leader in our movement who quoted that realization in Ukraine, and somebody questioned him, who is the devotee that has given this realization that milk started boiling because it was, how can milk think, you know, how can milk have a mind of its own? So then that query started floating around on emails, and I was one of the receivers of that email. And I thought, there is one Acharya who knows, you know, why everything is happening. So I looked up the commentary of Sri Hari Sur, and there it was. The milk started boiling because the milk was thinking. And then I quoted this entire verse by him. So he is the one who has written that realization. Why did the milk start boiling? If we ever hear that realization in any of the class as to why the milk started boiling, so the credit is not given to that person, but it is he who wrote it. So I went to Nasik for 3 days. They organized a 3-part seminar. And I immediately felt a reciprocation, because in this seminar, the audience that came was something which I had never expected in my life. Usually, I am used to an audience of 50, 60, 100 devotees. On the first day, 2,000 devotees came to hear. These were 2000 live days. This was 2019 BC, before Corona. So it was in 2019 BC, and I was visiting Nasik, and 2000 devotees came. They personally, they were not present online. They were there personally present. 2000 devotees came on the first day. And on the second day, a very special thing happened. Somebody informed me that before the second day's katha, that today the descendant of Sri Hari Suri has been informed he is going to come to the katha. On the second day, his descendant came to the katha. And on the second day, during the katha, there is a video of it. His descendant was welcomed in the temple. And he said something, I will tell you everything about Hari Suri ji, whatever you want to know. So I asked him everything that is needed to be asked. So I got it right from the sources. He said, till today his samadhi was not open to anyone besides our family, but today I will, you know, open that samadhi for you, and you can visit his samadhi and pay your obeisances to him. If you are translating his work, you will need his blessings. So I said, yes, I would like to go to his samadhi. So we went to his samadhi, which is near the river Godavari in Nasik, and he told us that our ancestor Sri Hari Suri is 5 generations previous to us. He said it's 5 generations previous to us. So he was a lifelong kirtaniya in the sampradaya of Tukaram Maharaj. That is what he said. So very clearly established. He was a lifelong kirtaniya in the sampradaya of Tukaram Maharaj. Now all of us know how Tukaram Maharaj is connected to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So because it is said very clearly by Srila Prabhupada that he was initiated by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and he was given the mantra Ram Krishna Hari. And Tukaram Maharaj himself admits that I got this mantra from Baba Chaitanya. So this is what Tukaram Maharaj admits, I got this mantra from Baba Chaitanya. So I also wanted to see the temple where he wrote some of his realizations. So I went to the temple where Sri Hari Suri would often sit in meditation and would write his realizations. So this temple today is known as the Venkateshwar Balaji temple. It's on the other side of the Godavari river. This is the same temple that Srila Prabhupada visited when he was in Nasik. And this is the same temple that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visited 500 years ago when he came to Nasik. So there is a mention of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visiting Nasik. And that is the temple where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visited. There is a deity of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in that temple. In that temple in Nasik. So I took photographs of all that deity in the entire temple, and I have saved it as documentation, because this documentation is very important. This personality is belonging to the sampradaya of Tukaram Maharaj, who is connected to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So it's a branch of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's sampradaya, because Tukaram Maharaj started this Sankirtan in Maharashtra. So Sri Hari Suri's service was to write this Bhakti Rasayanam, and in Chaturmasya, in the 4 months of rainy season, he would perform Kirtan Seva. Kirtan Seva means there used to be 3,000 or 4,000 people gathering in the temple at night. In that temple courtyard, Sri Hari Suri will stand for the entire night and speak Katha. So for the entire night, he will not sleep. He will stand and deliver Katha, and 5,000 people minimum used to be present. and there were no microphones, no nothing. And they used to speak katha simply on the strength of their voice. That was their ability to speak at that point of time. So Sri Hari Suri, he was capable of speaking katha to so many people at the same time. And this was his primary service, performing kirtana by speaking Hari Katha to all the devotees during Chaturmas. And he spent 36 Chaturmases, which means 36 years of his life, he spent doing this service. And then he trained, he had only one disciple in his life. His disciple's name was Sri Govinda. And his disciple had a very sweet voice. And he told his disciple one thing, you should, whenever you retire in your life, you should take sannyas. And you should form two mathas, you should form two temples. One should be known as Sri Radha Krishna Math, where you should worship a deity of Radha and Krishna. And another math should be known as Sri Chaitanya Math. So I'm going to find out more about it. I'm in the process of research. Still facts are coming out. But previously a lot was unknown about this commentator. His realizations were quoted many times in devotee circles, but the name of the personality was not being quoted. So gradually these things may come out if Krishna so desires. So I pray to Srila Prabhupada. He named one disciple after Sri Hari Suri. I pray to Srila Prabhupada that, oh, Prabhupada, if it is your desire that this commentary should come out and inspire the devotees, so you please give me the strength to achieve that in some way or the other. So I hope that answers the question, Matari.
Haripo. Prabhuji, for the sake of time, if it's okay, I'll just start reading off the chat questions. Yeah. Is that okay?
Sure, it's sure.
7:20 your time. So from Pranav Prabhu, from a YouTube channel, he's asking, can only Lord Krishna or Vishnu Tattvas give liberation? Is there any mention in Srimad Bhagavatam that any of Devatas like Lord Ganesh, Mother Durga, Lord Shiva, etc. can give liberation?
Okay.
He's asking. Bhagavatam.
Okay. So, can any of the other deities give liberation? So, the thing is, it's very clearly one of the names of Lord Krishna is Mukunda. Mukunda is Mukum. Mukum means Muktim Dadati Iti Mukunda. Actually, he is the one who gives liberation. He is the one who bestows liberation. In some cases, Lord Shiva, because Lord Shiva is also Guna Avatar of Lord Vishnu. He also can bestow impersonal liberation, or he also can bestow his abode Kailash on certain followers. But other than Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva, Lord Vishnu Tattva and Shiva Tattva, other deities don't have that capability of giving liberation directly because they don't have a spiritual world of themselves. So only those deities can give liberation into the spiritual world who have a spiritual world of themselves. So that is the answer to that question.
Okay.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Follow-up question is there, Prabhuji. So, devotees who worship Lord Venkateshwara, where do they go, Prabhuji? They go to spiritual world or there is any special planet of Lord Balaji?
So every deity has his special planet. So, for Lord, whether it is for Lord Venkateshwara, because his name is also mentioned in, I think in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Vyasadeva mentions about, in the Bhagavatam or in some Puranas it is mentioned, his name is also mentioned. So, all the deities whose names are mentioned, they are having their eternal homes in the spiritual world. And those who are dedicated followers of such Vishnu Tattvas, they can attain to the respective Vaikuntha planets. So, even for Lord Venkateshwara, because he is a separate form. Now, it's not that this form was suddenly created one day, because there is a pastime associated, of course, that Lord wants. There is an entire pastime behind Lord Venkateshwara. But one should understand that this form was not created on that day when the Lord desired. This form is eternal. The Lord only manifested that form from the spiritual world in the material world on that specific day when this pastime took place. So, I hope that answers the query, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you. So, Prabhuji, next question is from chat from Gopinath Acharya Prabhu.
Right.
He's remembering where Shukadev Goswami compares the falling of Putana to the falling of Ritasura.
Right.
And he's contrasting that Prithasura is a great devotee and his prayers are sung by devotees. Mm-hmm. Is there a reason why his falling is compared with that of falling Putana?
Okay. I would just like to answer this question, because this question is answered in the commentary of Sri Vallabhacharya. So I would like to just quickly take one angle. There may be other acharyas who may have answered this, but I quickly read something from Sri Vallabhacharya yesterday. I would like to share that on the screen, and if Prabhu can see the Sanskrit here. So this is what Sri Vallabhacharya says. My cursor is highlighting it. Vritra Iveti. Vritra Iveti means like Vritrasur. Sri Vallabhacharya says, Vritra Svechayapi Patati Tataha Punar Uthanam Bhaved Iti. So sometimes he says Vritrasur would fall on his own accord and then get up again. But Vajrahata Ityuktam, but it is said like Vritra who was attacked by the Vajra, by the thunderbolt of Indra. But when Vritrasur was attacked by the thunderbolt of Indra, he could not get back up again. So the entire analogy is not simply that she fell like Vritrasur, but she fell like Vritrasur who was struck by Indra's thunderbolt. So the entire point in conveying that is, just as Vritrasur, who used to rise up again and again after falling down, but he did not rise up again after being struck by the thunderbolt. So similarly, Sri Vallabhacharya says that the analogy here is to prove that just as Vritrasur did not rise up after being struck by the thunderbolt, similarly, she did not rise up after being sucked by, after her life airs were sucked by Lord Krishna. So that is the entire point of the analogy. So I hope that answers the question.
Very clear, Prabhuji. So next question, Srinath Prabhu, are you still online? Would you like to say your question out?
Yes, Prabhu. So just for the time's sake, I will just go to the point. My questions. I mean, this is from yesterday class where you mentioned like Putana is a infant killer, and then Brahma comes and do with Shashti Devi and write down the fate on the sixth day. So my question is, what is the ultimate fate of those infants which were killed by Putana? Because clearly after such abominable act, Putana got something so rare and precious,
right,
for an ordinary jiva.
So Sri Vallabhacharya says in his commentary that Putana used to eat all those children. Not only would she kill those children by administering them poison, she was also a demon, and demons usually are cannibals. They eat humans also. So all those children were in the stomach of Putana, and Sri Vallabhacharya makes a point that, you know, when when they were in the stomach of Putana, so their bodies are still there in the stomach of Putana. So, and their souls are still waiting to get another body. So when she is killed, so the Lord comes in touch with her body, so her entire body is purified. But along with her body, because the bodies of those infants are also within her stomach, their bodies are also purified. And for this reason, all those living entities who were killed by her also attained liberation. So this is the standpoint taken by Sri Vallabhacharya. Sri Srinath Chakravarti, whose name is the same as your name, Prabhu, Srinath Chakravarti, he says so that she did not kill any children. She was just looking for children. So the first child she saw was Krishna. So that is the opinion of Srila Srinath Chakravarti. So both opinions have been given. First opinion is that she killed some children, but when Krishna killed her, his touch was also experienced by the bodies of those children. Those bodies got purified, and the souls who were waiting to take another birth did not have to take another birth. They immediately went back home, back to God. So this is the answer given by Sri Vallabhacharya. And Srila Srinath Chakravarti says nobody was killed by her. She was simply searching for boys, but the first boy whom she found was Krishna. So I hope that clarifies the answer for you.
Yeah, Prabhu. I have two more questions, like on similar line. Like, what is the fate of babies which dies or miscarried or aborted before 6 days, like before the destiny of such infant is written by the Lord Brahma?
So some infants come with a prarabdha karma that they will not even come out of the womb. So that is the prarabdha karma with which some infants come to this world. And some infants come with the prarabdha karma that they will come in this world, but they will die within a few days, maybe 4-6 days. So that prarabdha karma is decided when the soul enters into the womb. But what happens is that when it is said that on the 6th day, Lord Brahma comes and writes the destiny, what happens is that on the 6th day, whatever destiny was there for, whatever destiny is there for the child who is surviving even for 6 days, that Brahma has to come and write it in the destiny of that particular child, whatever events are going to happen. This is something which the astrologers or students of Jyotish say. So otherwise, for a child who dies before that, for them it is as good as not having taken a birth at all, because they could not even survive for a single week in this world. It's as good as they did not live in this world at all. It's as good as they did not take birth in this human body, because they could not enjoy even 1 week of stay in this human body. So their destiny was already fixed in the previous life, and therefore they could not survive even for 1 week. But those who survive even for 1 week and their destiny is fixed on the 6th day, before 1 week is over, their destiny is fixed on the 6th day by Lord Brahma, and he is accompanied by Shashti Devi. So that is what is written in Jyotish Shastra.
The last one is like, you know, what is the fate of persons performing or engaged in the act of putana, like killing of infants? In modern society, the putana is acting in a different way.
So it is very clear that such a person who engages in killing other living entities, that person has to definitely face the reaction of whatever they have done. Because Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to say these things, Swakarma Phal Bhukpuman, which means a person definitely has to face the reaction of whatever karma they have done. Yatha Dhenu Sahasreshu Vatso Vindati Mataram. That just as a calf is able to locate its mother even amongst millions of cows, similarly, karma finds its recipient amongst millions of people. So that is the example given in Shastra. So I hope that clarifies.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you.
A follow-up question, Prabhuji. Like you mentioned that Brahma, along with Shashti Devi, comes and writes the destiny. So for us also, the persons, I mean humans who are taking birth on the earthly planet, for them also same thing happens on the 6th day, Brahma comes and writes the destiny along with Shashti Devi?
Yeah. For the humans, it is said. Brahma comes with Shashti Devi for all humans. But since those who become devotees, it is not applicable for them. I showed Pramanas yesterday. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that prarabdha karma is erased for a devotee, especially at the time of initiation. So it is not applicable for a devotee. But Jyotish Shastra says, so I quoted on the authority of Jyotish Shastra. Jyotish Shastra says that Lord Brahma along with Shashti Devi write the destiny of a conditioned soul on the 6th day, especially a human being on the 6th day after they take birth. So that is what is said.
So Prabhuji, we are not born as a devotees. Only after a certain point of time we were introduced in Krishna consciousness. So on the 6th day of the our birth, Brahma must have come and written the destiny, right?
Yes. So that prarabdha was there for us before we got initiated. Even those who are born in devotee families, they may be having prarabdha karma, but that prarabdha is erased when they take initiation. So at the time of initiation, all karma is taken away. Because initiation is not by birth. We have to understand that entire devotee culture is not by birth. It is by initiation. That is what we have to understand. Otherwise, devotees will become another version of Smartha Brahmanas. He is a devotee by birth, so he doesn't have karma. We have to understand that the entire devotee culture is not by birth. It is through initiation. So this we have to understand.
So children born in the devotee family are also not considered as a, you know, I mean.
No, because there are many children born in devotee families who may not become devotees. They have to face prarabdha karma. There is no doubt about this. But as much as they have chanted, that much Sukriti they will get. But if they become initiated devotees, if they become serious devotees, then if they change their gotra to Achyut gotra, then definitely they will be protected by the Lord.
Okay, Prabhu, thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Very nice, wonderful class. Just a follow-up question, Prabhuji. Two questions, Prabhuji. One is regarding this writing the fate on the 60th day, because in Bhagavad Gita it says Yamyam Vyapeswaram Bhava, right? At the time of death, whatever state of mind we are in, we get to the next. So again, why there should be a Brahma writing our on the 60th day?
Sure.
So that's one question. Second question is, like for doctors, some people have to do abortion. By some situations, they have to do abortion, right? It's something like killing a life. So what we should understand? Because in villages, some people will come and they wanted to remove the baby. So what the doctor agrees to that, what happens?
Right.
Thank you.
So the first question is, if Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Yam Yam Bhavam, that whatever state of mind one quits one's body in, one attains that in their next life. So what is the point of Lord Brahma coming on the sixth day and writing the destiny? So whatever mood one has at the time of death, whatever one thinks at the time of death, that becomes one's next body for a human being, not for everybody else, only for a human being. Why? Karmanu bandini manushya loke. All these laws are for manushya, manushya loka. Animals, they are progressing according to their sequence of evolution in the spiritual cycle. They are progressing according to their spiritual evolution in the 84 lakh species. For a human being, Lord Krishna has said, whatever he thinks of at the moment of death, that he becomes in the next life. And the major details are decided there. But what is the prarabdha karma, the combination of good and bad that that particular living entity will get? Those are details which cannot be thought of at the moment of death. So those details are decided by Lord Brahma and given in the next life. So that is why Lord Brahma writes the destiny, because the next body is decided at the moment of death. But what positive and negative reactions are going to be received in that body is to be decided by Lord Brahma and the other agents who help him in the universe. So that is what it is. This is the first question. Second, if somebody is working as a doctor and has to perform abortions, well, there are so many professions which are not so nice, even though they may appear to us as very polished professions. You know, for example, when we say, if somebody were to ask, what if somebody is a butcher in a supermarket? It is their duty. So in modern India, this philosophy has somehow come about that work is worship. Karma hi puja hai. So if that work may be a butcher or maybe a doctor performing an abortion, and everybody thinks that, you know, karma is karmanye vadhikar aste ma phaleshu kadach. This has become standard Indian philosophy today, that you should perform your karma. And performing karma means going to the office. That is what is the meaning of performing karma. So the traditional definition of karma is what is given in the Vedas according to our varna and ashram. That is the meaning of karma. So perform your prescribed duty. Therefore, Prabhupada used to translate karma as prescribed duty, not as going to the office. So in modern India, people misunderstand perform your karma means go to the office and work hard. Perform your karma means perform your karma in your situation in the varna and ashram institution. That is the meaning of performing karma. And if somebody is a devotee or even a spiritualist and they understand that one should not kill other living entities, then by all means they will resist and they will stop the killing of other living entities. So this is very clear that a devotee does not engage in any violence at any point of time in any way. So this should be clear to anybody who is a spiritualist or a devotee. And anybody who is not a spiritualist or a devotee, if they have done that, then there is some prayaschit also. There is some atonement for sins that have been committed out of ignorance. So there is some prayaschitta for that also mentioned in Shastra. So that prayaschitta is mentioned in many places in Shastra. There is a prayaschitta for bhrunhatya. Bhrunhatya means for aborting a child. That is also mentioned in Shastra. But the best prayaschitta, the best atonement is to become a devotee. That is the best atonement that one, and one to never repeat that. That is the best atonement that one can have in one's life. So I hope that answers both your questions.
Yes, Prabhu, thank you. And Prabhuji, and Krishna also specified in Bhagavad Gita about the sixth chapter, right? About the unsuccessful yogi. So basically, do we consider to be unsuccessful yogis? Like we go to temple, we perform chanting, and are we considered to be in that platform of unsuccessful yogis because Krishna promised that he will be getting back? Like he will take a birth in Brahmana family or in an aristocratic family, based on like in the sixth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, he was saying about that. So like are the unsuccessful yogi platform is different from like sadhaka bhaktas, or they're different or same?
Yeah, when he says unsuccessful yogi, yogi means any type of yogi, ashtanga yogi, gyan yogi, karma yogi, and also it includes bhakti yogi. There are individuals who have failed even in bhakti yoga. Bharat Maharaj is an example of that. He could not make it in that life, although he had the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his guru. Lord Rishabhdev was his guru, but he could not make it back to Godhead in that life. So Bharat Maharaj had to take another birth as a deer, and after that he had to take another birth as Jad Bharat. Of course, it's an example to show that one should be careful at the moment of death. But still Bharat Maharaj was performing bhakti yoga, and still Bharat Maharaj could not make it back home, back to Godhead. And then because of that, after that dear birth, he took birth in the family of a Brahmana. It says Yoga Brashto bhi jayate. A Yoga Brashta takes birth in the family of a Brahmana. So one can infer by looking at devotees who have taken birth in Brahmana families or who have taken birth in very rich families that these may be, one cannot say certainly, these may be individuals who are yoga bhrashta, who could not make it in their past lives, and they are trying once again in this life to make it back home, back to God. So that is the answer to your question.
So Prabhuji, who takes birth in aristocratic family, they don't be devotees, right? They will be enjoying their luxuries. Like you take birth in Bill Gates' family, why we will think about Krishna? Because we are surrounded by so much of wealth, and when Krishna comes into our mind. Yeah. So why Krishna gives that opportunity to take birth in aristocratic family?
Yeah, it's also mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita that he revives his purva samskars from there. It doesn't only take birth in aristocratic family, it takes birth with the samskars. So taking birth in aristocratic family is possible for anyone who has pious karma, some pending pious karma. But taking birth in aristocratic family for a devotee is so that his financial anxieties are taken care of. That is the purpose of giving them birth in an aristocratic family. Like Raghunath Das Goswami, he was not born in a Brahmana family, but he was in aristocratic family. Of course, he's an eternal associate of the Lord. But this, he was so aristocratic that he had no work to do. Just he has a zamindar. Zamindar means he should take care of the land and the servants will do all the work. So if you're born in a zamindar family, you don't have to worry about a career. That's the purpose of taking birth in an aristocratic family. You don't have to worry about a career in the material world. And the benefit of taking birth in a Brahmana family is that you don't have to take any anxieties about getting spiritual knowledge. In your family lineage, you will get all the spiritual knowledge that is required. So these two births are very special, especially for a yoga brashta.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, it's, I know, getting late. We'll just, do you have time for two questions that were posted in the chat window?
Sure.
Okay. I think for the sake of time, we should probably end at that point.
Sure.
Given the time frame for Prabhuji, India is past 7:30 p.m. So, and then there are two questions about Sampradaya and where does Shri Hari Suri Prabhu belong to. I think you've answered that extensively today. So I would defer to those devotees to simply look at the video on YouTube, if that's okay. So there's a question by
Radhika Mataji, I don't know whether she's still online, saying, Hare Krishna Prabhuji, can you help me understand what three heads represent? And specifically, Prabhuji, this is coming from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 6, Chapter 9, Verse 4, about Indradev cutting off the head of Vishwarup, and specifically cutting three heads from his shoulder. It's 6.9.4. So Mataji is asking that particular question. What does the three heads represent?
What does the three head represent? In the next verse itself, it is given that the one head was meant for drinking somaras, another meant for...
yes, Prabhu.
Yes, drinking wine, and the third head was meant for eating food. So those were the heads, and he's not a human being, so he is a celestial being. So he can have more than one head.
So what should we derive out of that, Prabhu? Like, you know, what does it mean when you talk about one head drinking wine? I mean, what should we infer out from that? Because I don't have any purport reference that details what should I understand from that?
It's my initial thought is that because he is a perfect Purohit. Purohit means a perfect Brahmana, and Brahmana, usually a Brahmana can perform one function at a time. He is such a perfect Brahmana, he can perform all the functions of a Yajna simultaneously. That is the purpose of having more than one head. So that may be the reason why it is mentioned. But I will still look into the commentaries, and I will try to find if there is any explanation given. I will show you on the screen. The commentators, what they have said about this. So I am sharing my screen with you. You can see here. This is verse 694. And na katamen api vyakhyatam. Nobody has commented. No Sridhar Swami, Jiv Goswami, Vishwanath Chakravarti. No commentary. 695. So only Jiv Goswami says Kapinjala Chaiti Tittari. Kapinjala is a word named as Sittari. So no commentary on the secrets behind the three heads. So the only thing now, since there is no previous commentator who has said anything, so I can only give what I feel is the logical explanation behind this. The thing is, the Purohits have to perform various functions at various points of time. Sometimes eating some remnants from Yajna, sometimes uttering mantras. So this is a Purohit who can perform all those functions simultaneously. He doesn't have to perform them at different points of time. And that is what makes him the most efficient Purohit of the demigods.
Thank you, Prabhuji. So last question from Achyuta Kumar Das Prabhu, saying, why did Jad Bharat speak out to King Rahugna, but he remained silent with his family brothers and the dacoits who tried to kill him?
Right. So why did Jad Bharat suddenly speak up when he was to Rahugan, when specifically Rahugan spoke something to him, whereas he did not speak up when his family members were giving him so many troubles? So this is answered in the Srimad Bhagavatam itself, and I will show the specific verse, which is 5.13.24. You can see the verse. He says, Shukdev Goswami continued, oh, my dear king, O son of Mother Uttara, there were some waves of dissatisfaction in the mind of Jad Bharat due to his being insulted by King Rahugan, who made him carry his palanquin. But Jad Bharat neglected this, and his heart again became calm and quiet like an ocean. So this is the primary reason mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam itself, that there were some waves of dissatisfaction in his heart, and that is the reason why Jad Bharat spoke something. Now the question is, how can waves of dissatisfaction arise in the heart of such a perfect living entity as Jad Bharat too? So that is also answered in the 11th canto by Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna in the 11th canto, in the chapter of the Avanti Brahmana, Lord Krishna says to Uddhav, and I want to show this, that even when great personalities become hurt by sharp words. So I'm showing this verse, the first verse. the second and third verse. Yes, Lord Krishna says 11:23:2. O disciple of Brihaspati, there is virtually no saintly man in this world capable of resettling his own mind after it has been disturbed by insulting words of uncivilized men. So this is very clear statement by Lord Krishna. There is virtually no saintly man, and that also includes Jad Bharat. Because he was insulted by Rahugan's sharp words, so for some time he could not settle his mind. In the next verse, Krishna says, sharp arrows which pierce one's chest and reach the heart do not cause as much suffering as the arrows of harsh, insulting words that become lodged within the heart when spoken by uncivilized men. So these two words very clearly say that even great souls sometimes become affected by the sharp words of uncivilized men. And in the words of Shukdev Goswami itself, I have specified that Jad Bharat had some dissatisfaction in his mind, and that dissatisfaction was the reason for his speaking out in this way.
Okay, thank you very much, Prabhuji. We look forward to, thank you for sharing your valuable time with your various other services and your commitments to other communities as well.
Thank you so much, Prabhu.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji. We look forward. And we'll join tomorrow, Prabhuji. It's a little different timing. I'm sorry, we've had three different timings for three different days. So tomorrow would be your IST, 6:30 p.m. Pacific time, 6:30. So yours would be 6:30 a.m. Ours would be 6 p.m.
Okay.
Okay. And that's indicated in the flyer. Does that work for you okay?
Yes, definitely.
And then for those devotees that are still hanging on, please simply look at the tiny URL, schedule, and that should clarify everything. Everybody's thanking you very much for your wonderful class and the way you've explained a pretty broad gamut of questions, even beyond this one particular pastime. So thank you very much, Prabhuji. His Grace, Hari Parshad Prabhu Ki Jai.
Shri Prabhupada Ki Jai.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Take care, Prabhuji. See you tomorrow. Krishna willing.
Hare
Krishna. Thank you.
Hare Bol. Thank
you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.